To download more lectures, learn more about our project, and to help support it, visit www.bayinah.com/dream. That's BAYYINAH/dream. You are free to share these recordings with family and friends. Thank you and Jazakumullah khairan for helping us make our dream a reality.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم عما يتساءلون عن النبأ العظيم الذي هم فيه مختلفون كلا سيعلمون ثم كلا سيعلمون الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين ثم أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته إن شاء الله تعالى the intent of this series of durus is to cover as much of Juz Amma as possible. My intention for picking this particular section of the Qur'an is because it's the most commonly memorized and most commonly recited portion of the Qur'an, and so it's probably most beneficial and most relevant to the average Muslim, inshallah ta'ala. Just a few things in the introduction as to how we're going to be going about this tafsir. Really, what I would recommend for anybody who's listening, inshallah, to the recordings and also you guys that are attending live, is that you study a tafsir on your own as a complement to this, at least one tafsir. At the very least, I would recommend going through Tafsir ibn Kathir, rahimahullah, at least that much, because that's available in English. As much as you can do of your own in terms of the readings as possible. And then inshallah ta'ala, what we're going to be sharing here is something a little bit that complements what's already been read and what's already been researched or available to you easily. One of the fundamental purposes of this series is to illustrate how the Qur'an or every surah of the Qur'an is a cohesive argument. How it's unified and its subject matter is presented in a coherent fashion. So inshallah ta'ala, because this is one of the aspects of tafsir that gets overlooked, in that when you are studying the tafsir of one ayah and every word or every little grammatical nuance and you go so far in depth into it, which is great, what ends up happening is you lose sight of the bigger picture. How is everything connected? How is this part of one discourse? Because you understand that this was originally recited without any tafsir. This was recited to an audience and there was no explanation. They were just hearing the words one ayah after another and they were processing this stuff. And first and foremost, we understand that Meccan Qur'an in particular, it was being recited to predominantly a not believing audience. So you know, for believers at least afterwards, they can stop at every ayah and ask questions from the people of knowledge and learn more and more about the ayat. But first and foremost, Meccan Qur'an, and you know, Juz Amma is a great example of and a good selection of Meccan Qur'an, is a discourse that is almost a message being delivered to non-believers. So it's a clear discourse in and of itself. So we're going to try to explore some of the clarity of thought and the organization of ideas that are presented in each and every surah. Just a few introductory comments about surah, the surah in Quran in general. One of the most common, I think, in Wallahu A'lam, in my opinion, the mistranslations of surah is chapter. That a surah is typically called a chapter of the Quran. You know, a chapter is basically one fundamental lesson. Okay, a chapter is trying to teach you one fundamental lesson, one central idea. A surah, however, can have many, many, many ideas. A surah, closer in academic terms, the closest thing to a surah you could probably have is a course of study. So every surah is almost, you know, an independent study in and of itself, even though each of these studies are connected to other studies in the Quran. So for example, Surah Al-Baqarah is connected to Surah Ali Imran and so on and so forth. Their interrelationships. But a surah in and of itself isn't really a chapter for many reasons. One of which was that it covers more than one topic and it's diverse in its topics. The second reason is that a chapter has a chronological or numerical kind of sequence. So you have chapter 1, then chapter 2, then chapter 3, then chapter 4. And if you learn something in chapter 4, you don't have to repeat it in chapter 5. And if there's a need to repeat it, the author will say, go refer back to chapter 4. He's not going to write it over again in chapter 5. But in Qur'an, Allah repeats things a lot. right? It's not like a chapter in a book. It's entirely different. Another reason we call it an independent entity is that in the Quran, for example, in Surah An-Nur, Allah calls the surah kitab. He calls a surah a book in and of itself. So He gives it a term that is used for an independent entity also. So for these few reasons, and finally for a linguistic reason, the word surah, literally, it comes from the outer walls of a city. And you know, if you can visualize, in ancient cities, they didn't have borders or signs on the highway that said, welcome to this and this city. Rather, it was these outer walls that you had to go through. This was their security means, right? And inside the city, there's a lot going on. There's commerce taking place, there's residential areas, there's military, there's government, there's all these different things are happening, but somehow they're all connected and make one city. So that's kind of like what a surah is. There's a lot going on inside the surah, but somehow it's all organized and connected and forms a unified whole. So inshallah ta'ala, these are the few things we're going to explore. Two other things that we're going to try to highlight that are not as well documented in English literature at least. One is the relationship of the beginning of a surah with the end of the surah. And this is a consistent feature of the Quran, that every surah, somehow what it begins with is somehow connected to what it ends with. There's a cohesion between the beginning and the end of the surah. So the Mafatih al-Surah, the beginning, the openers of the surahs, and the Khawatim. Also, there is a cohesion between the last thing you will read about in the previous surah and the first thing you will read about in the next surah. So there's a link between the conclusion of one surah to the introduction to, from the introduction to the next. And like we said, we're beginning with Juz Amma, inshallah ta'ala. So now with Juz Amma and Surah Naba being the 78th surah of the Qur'an, the surah before it is Surah Al-Mursalat, surah number 77. And in surah number 77, we found two groups. إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي ظِلَالٍ وَعُيُونٍ in ayah number 41, the people of taqwa have been mentioned. And we will find in Juz Amma also towards the conclusion, we'll find the mention of the people of taqwa again. Also in Surah Al-Mursalat, the people that are referred to over and over again, the fundamental theme of Surah Al-Mursalat, the surah before, is وَيْلُوا يَوْمَ إِذِلِّ الْمُكَذِّبِينَ. This is the oft-repeated ayah of Surah Al-Mursalat, in which the Al-Mukadhibin are being highlighted. These are the people who deliberately lie against the truth. They don't just lie, they lie against the people who speak the truth. So they accuse them of wrong, and they try to basically nullify their or invalidate their character and things like this. So they're falsifiers, they're propagators of falsehood. These are the Mukadhibin. Now, Surah Naba begins with the phrase, عَمَّ يَتَسَأَلُونَ. It begins with this common phrase that is very famous and commonly translated regarding what are they asking one another. It's a common, easy, simple translation of عَمَّ يَتَسَاءَلُونَ. So let's talk a little bit about tasa'ul so we understand the connection between surah number 77, the surah that came before, and its conclusions with what is coming now. Here we have Allah Azza wa Jal speaking about, or Allah commenting on a discussion taking place between disbelievers. There are three opinions about the word, the tafsir of the word yatasa'alun. First of all, its basic meaning, yas'alu ba'duhum ba'da. What that means is, yatasa'alun means they're asking one another. Some of them are asking others. One opinion is, this is a depiction of believers being asked by disbelievers. That's one opinion. Another opinion is, this is a discourse that is taking place between the disbelievers. They're asking among each other. And a third position is that both the believers and the disbelievers are asking the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The rajih position, the closest to true position, and the one that's supported in the text and also with other evidences, is the one that this is a discussion taking place of the kuffar among themselves. Okay, this is a discussion, or they're asking one another, each other, the kuffar among each other. But the thing is, we have to understand in language, when you mutually ask a question to one another, when you're discussing something with one another, it can be done for one of two reasons. It can be done because you're curious, you don't know, and you're asking somebody, and they're asking somebody else, and this is what's happening, right? So it's sort of an inquisitive intent. Another intent for asking one another is actually to undermine or to wage sarcasm at someone else. For example, just picture this scenario: the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam presents these phenomenal truths about the afterlife, right? These huge things are going to happen. The oceans are going to boil over. The dead are going to come back to life. These huge things he's talking about, and as a means of undermining or making him look like he's insane, they say, "You know, do you know what he's talking about?
No, do you know what he's talking about? And they're kind of talking to each other. And this is a means of insulting him. Right? So the previous surah talked about those who do takdeeb. وَيْلٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ لِلْمُكَذِّبِينَ. And one of the most effective ways of doing takdeeb is to mock or to undermine the statements of the other by means of sarcastic questions among yourselves. So this is what they were doing. They were saying, come on, really, we're going to come back to life? Is that what he's really saying? Or he was saying that the mountains are going to sail away, or they're going to turn into carded wool. Or he's talking about us coming out of our graves like locusts. What's he talking about? You know, so this tone of undermining that we even know in language today, this is the tone that they were using. Now understand and appreciate this. The one responding to this in Surah Naba is Allah. Allah is basically listening to their conversation. So there's a third party here. The messenger is obviously a listener, a party to this conversation. The believers who are making da'wah are hearing this sarcastic conversation. But from the very beginning we learn there's a third party that is also listening to this discourse. It is Allah Azza wa Jal. And now Allah is depicting His reaction to their conversation. So what we learn in the beginning of the surah is Allah has taken offense to their sarcasm. Allah has taken offense to the way they speak about the Akhirah. So Allah says, عَمَّ يَتَسَأَلُونَ. Now, just to add some context to what kinds of questions they're adding, because they've been asked all over the Quran. إِذَا كُنَّا عِظَامًا وَرُفَاتًا أَإِنَّا لَمَبْعُثُونَ خَلْقًا جَدِيدًا. When we have been reduced to bones and decayed dust, you know, and when we just withered away in our graves, we're going to be raised again, a new creation altogether. These are the kinds of questions they were asking. When Allah Azza wa Jalla said, عَلَيْهَا تِسْعَةَ عَشَرَ, right, on the hellfire there are 19 guardians of the angels, 19 have been appointed. One of them got up and said, well, they're just 19, I can take on that many. I can handle that much, it shouldn't be that big of a deal. So these are the kinds of criticisms and questions they were poking at the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam with. Which is why I would say, you know, nowadays a lot of times youth, they fall into these, you know, missionary websites or comments under some da'wah lecture by some atheist or by some agnostic on YouTube that's writing some really blasphemous stuff. It's nothing new. They were saying this in the face of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anyhow. So Allah responds, عَمَّ يَتَسَأَلُونَ عَنِ النَّبَإِ الْعَظِيمِ. And this is a continuation of the question. Are they really asking about النَّبَأُ الْعَظِيمِ? النَّبَأ in Arabic means news, but there's another word in Arabic for news which is خَبَر. So there are two words now, there's نَبَأ and there's خَبَر. What's the difference between نَبَأ and خَبَر? First of all, النَّبَأُ أَعْظَمُ, meaning نَبَأ is a greater kind of news. It's a more important news. That's one difference between نَبَأ and خَبَر. So you don't use نَبَأ for anything. Like if you know the store closes at 10 o'clock, that may be khabar. It's not naba. But you know, somebody won the election, or there's a war that started, or something huge happened, that would be considered naba. And that's how it's used in the Qur'an. Khabar, by the way, is used in the Qur'an twice, both times for the same context. When Musa alayhi salam is coming, or is with his family in the desert and it's dark, and he sees a light from the distance, he tells them, maybe I'll get some khabar from there. Okay? أَتِيكُمْ بِخَبَرٍ. Maybe I'll bring you some kind of news. He doesn't know what the news is going to be. Maybe they'll have some beneficial information. He's not sure, so he uses the word khabar. But when Allah speaks of nations that are destroyed in the past, Allah speaks of أَنْبَاءُ مَا كَانُوا بِهِ يَسْتَزِئُونَ نَبَأُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. The news of those who came before, but huge events. So this is the first difference between naba and khabar. The second thing is, naba necessarily has a benefit. It is a news information that has some benefit for the person receiving it. Also, it demands a reaction, it demands an action. It's not just something you could say, oh, that's nice, and you sit there. But naba is something when you hear it, it demands that you change something about yourself. Like naba would be, there's a fire in the building. Right? Now, what does it demand from you? I gotta get out of here. Or I gotta tell other people there's a fire. Right? So this is another difference between naba and khabar. And finally, naba has buhur in it, as the linguists argue. What that means is that it's a manifest event. You know, there are kinds of, there's abstract ideas and actual physical material events. Naba is a material event, something physical, something tangible, something you can see and touch. That's what a naba is. So when Allah speaks of the next life and resurrection as naba, He's referring to its tangible nature.